Hello friends, good afternoon and welcome to EduSat live lectures. Dear friends, today we are going to talk about global environmental conflicts. To discuss this topic, we have with us our subject expert, Dr. Mayank Kumar. Dr. Kumar is Associate Professor in Department of History in Satyavati College Evening in University of Delhi. Without further ado, I would like to welcome sir to our studios and request him to start the lecture.
Thank you.
Welcome sir.
Good afternoon viewers. Today we are here to discuss a very important and very contemporary topic, global environmental conflicts. When I was asked to deliver lecture on this, what we were thinking of developing it as a course on global environmental conflicts within the larger design of University Grants Commission's choice-based credit system. As you have, she has just introduced me that I teach at one of the College of Delhi University, we are also witnessing transition towards choice-based credit system. I'm not going to the merit or demerits of that system, but my intention is that at least we should offer to the student new kind of courses, and this is one of the attempt. My today's lecture is part of a longer series. It may be seen as a series and it may be seen as an independent individual lecture. Today's lecture will be basically divided into two parts, first part and the second part. First part is basically introducing the notion of why this topic is very relevant, and the second topic will in the end offer you a good bibliography which will tackle the first part as well. Now let me begin with what do I mean by global environmental conflicts and why is it necessary to have a discussion on this topic. It is also very pertinent for us to be aware that when we use this term global environmental conflicts, then what do we mean by that? First of all, global environmental conflicts are of multiple levels. One, between nations, within nation, within communities, and within individuals. This is when we discuss in terms of anthropocentrism, which means keeping humans at the center of this argument, then we treat this as in terms of nation, regions, and then the community and the individual, etc., etc. But when we place environment at the center of this argument, global environmental conflicts, then we suddenly realize that although we must be very careful in saying that environment has degraded. I am not suggesting that environment has never degraded earlier. Here what I mean, when I mean degraded, I especially would like to stress that degradation means human induced degradation. Please understand, the nature is not a static phenomena. It's a very, very dynamic phenomena. If it is very dynamic, which means it has kept on changing, it will keep on changing. It has it has its own understanding mechanism of change. I'm not going to comment on that. I'm not a geologist. What I'm basically focusing will be on humans' role in this change. One dimension. Second, what is also equally important for us to understand that most of the time the changes, the dynamism of environment is an inherent feature. It is part and parcel of the movements which environment witnesses. These movements may be very local, it can be regional, it can be national, it can be global, and it can be at the level of cosmos itself. So we are basically struggling or focusing on a very large landscape, at times narrowing down to a very local issue and at times broadening our issues to the impact of solar flares, the impact of comets, etc., etc. So we must understand that environment is not a given thing. It has evolved, it is evolving, and it will keep on evolving. In this process of change, where do we place humans? And how humans are leading to global environmental conflicts? Second issue, when I use the term conflict, then what I mean is conflict over resources. As a human beings, we are interested in resources provided by nature, provided by the environment. So there are certain sections, certain communities, certain nations, certain group of people who contest over these resources. So the conflict is over natural resources. So these global environmental conflicts, on the one hand, is addressing the issue of changes in the environment. On the other, the contestation over natural resources which are presently available. In this understanding, we must also understand a very important concept introduced by famous scientist M.S. Swaminathan. He suggested at one place that the earth is like a spaceship. It's a spaceship. What do we mean by spaceship? When we say spaceship, which means it's a spaceship, it has its own resources, it cannot increase its resources, it cannot decrease its resources. At the moment, though we have reached our moon, we have reached the Mars, but still we must understand that we are presently struggling with the resources available on Earth. So it's like a spaceship with its own limited resources. If resources are limited, then there is bound to be conflict. And are these conflicts affecting environment also? That is where we are trying to hit at, right? Now let me begin with my first slide, so that you will be able to comprehend what I am trying to argue. The first and foremost, we must understand nature is not static. It has never been, it will never be. Similarly, the change is a regular feature, and most of the time this has to be seen in geological times, not historical times. When we say historical times, what we mean is that history, as a professional historian I will define, a period for which we have written sources. The period for which we have sources, written sources, but we do not have understanding of those languages or signs, that is proto-history. And the period of human existence for which we do not have any written record, that is termed as prehistory. So I am not venturing into prehistory. I might venture into proto-history, but my focus will be on history, the period for which we have written records available for us. While focusing on history, we must also be very careful that we are not venturing into geological time. I am not giving history of environment. I am simply giving history of humans' interaction with environment and how that has shaped nature of various global environmental conflicts. As I have been mentioning, that nature is not static. So whenever the question of conservation arises, the basic problem with the concept I have is that at what moment do we want to conserve it? Do you want to conserve it when agriculture began? Do you want to conserve it when feudalism began? Do you want to conserve it when capitalism began? Or do you want to conserve it when you started thinking environment as an issue of human concern? That is as late as 1990s. So at what moment we want to conserve it? Most of the global climate summits are struggling with, they have date 2008, 2010, 2020, 2025, 2050. These are the points at which we want to conserve environment. But as I have been arguing and suggesting, that nature is not static. So this idea of conservation is very, very problematic. We in India are part of living in monsoon ecology. Our agriculture, our well-being is greatly dependent on monsoon. And you know, monsoon is very, very erratic, very, very variable. It doesn't follow a set pattern. If it doesn't follow a set pattern, despite the tremendous scientific knowledge which we have at our disposal, even America cannot determine the nature of monsoon. It is determined by such a large force called environment that it is beyond our control. So we have to continuously adapt to this. Whenever monsoon is delayed or monsoon is early, it creates problem for agrarian cycle. Since agrarian cycle is influenced, affected, so the production is affected. Since production is affected, so there is a conflict over the resources which agriculture sector produces, if I reduce it to such a small extent. But what I am trying to suggest is that environment has been changing. Monsoon, which is a regular feature, which has been lifeline of Indian civilization, is also very erratic. So we need to be very careful when we say we want to conserve. What do you want to conserve, and at what point would you like to conserve it? Similarly, the change is very natural, very, very natural. Let me give you another example. Change in terms of rivers change their course. It's a very normal phenomenon. I live in Delhi. and anybody who is from Delhi can understand, if you go, if you are on Ring Road behind the Lal Killa, the road itself is on the river bank of Yamuna. Yamuna has shifted northwards. Earlier it was much closer to Red Fort, now it is far away from Red Fort. It's very, very natural phenomena. Not long back, Yamuna was flowing westward towards Satluj and towards Arabian Sea. Due to geological movement, it shifted towards eastward. As we understand today, Indo-Gangetic Doab, Yamuna is integral part of that. But we know scientifically that Yamuna earlier used to flow towards west. It never came to east. So these are natural changes which have occurred, which will keep on occurring, and which is very, 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 very natural. Similarly, in terms of geological time, if I suggest you, Gondwana land was part of some other continent. Now it is part of Asia. The whole creation of Everest is because the Gondwana plate is hitting against the Eurasian plate. So these changes are very, very natural. We should not term them as degradation. The coming up of Everest cannot be in any manner, with any imagination, cannot be termed as degradation. So we have to be very, very careful, and it is not always easy to distinguish between human-made disasters, human-made degradations, and natural changes. So that line we have to continuously negotiate. And please bear with me when I overstep either side, because at times even we find it difficult to define in concrete terms, can we call it degradation? Or it is degradation only for us, the humans? Or it is degradation for the wildlife? It is degradation for the flora fauna? Another example might make you more comfortable, because most of you must have seen Ice Age. Most of you must have seen Jurassic Age. The dinosaurs were here on Earth and they wiped out without human intervention, because humans were not even in existence at that moment of time. So these changes have been taking place without intervention of humans. The mammoth animals like dinosaurs, they were living here, surviving here. There are various theories why they became extinct. But one thing is very sure, humans had no role to play in that. Similarly, various species, today we in India drink tea. Tea is a very common drink for us. It is not indigenous in a very strict sense of indigenous. Historians have argued, environmentalists have argued, that with the introduction of tea, the natural vegetation of Assam has changed. The natural ecosystem of Darjeeling has changed, because there were forests. Now forests have been reduced, converted into evergreen grasslands, evergreen shrublands. So these changes have taken place. I am reluctant to call it degradation, but definitely this change is human induced change, right? So we must understand that this is very natural, and we have to negotiate with these natural changes. Similarly, we trace beginning of these changes with the introduction of agriculture. Somewhere 14,000 years back, agriculture was introduced. Unless we had agriculture, we were living like animal. We were hunter-gatherers. We means humans. The next slide basically deals with that. We were living in at the moment we are living in interglacial period. There were ice age, which has gone, and now we are living in interglacial period. With the beginning of last interglacial period, we witnessed beginning of agriculture. Agriculture is a human activity. It is not a natural phenomenon. We treat it as a given thing, but we must be very careful that agriculture is not a natural phenomenon. It is human intervention in environment, and it has changed the whole landscape of most of the continents, because we have cleared forest for agricultural land. We have captured, colonized river banks in arid landscape. Harappa civilization, Mesopotamia, Mishr, all these are pre-Iron Age civilizations. And in all of these, there were no forests. It's basically the river valleys were used for agrarian production, which means the natural river valleys were converted into agricultural land. And you must understand, agriculture is a seasonal activity. It's not a annual activity. There is a season of 3 months, 4 months. Some crops take 9 months, some crops take 12 months, but it's a seasonal activity. So, as per our requirement, as per the requirements of humans, we have been cutting forest, eliminating it, using it for agriculture, and then once again leaving it. This system was known as, or still known as, shifting cultivation. Clear the forest, use that land for 3, 4, 5 years, till the moment the fertility of that land declines, you cut another patch of land, shift there, use that. And almost after 12 to 15 years, that previous land which we had cleared now is once again available for agriculture purposes. So, this has been very regular feature for human settlement. So, we have been in a way degrading environment with the coming of agriculture. We term, as a historian, we term it as a Neolithic revolution. Neolithic revolution, which means a new kind of tools were introduced. The implications were immense, revolutionary, because that was the period when we also domesticated animals. It is difficult to term which came first, agriculture or domestication of animals. But one thing we are very sure, that these both were almost coterminous, they came together. The impact of that, that we have converted a natural species into a domestic species. The body structure, especially the jaw of animals, change a lot when they are domesticated, because they are no longer hunting in wild, they are being fed by humans. So, their habits change, their eating habits change, so the structure of their jaws and their teeth changes. So, we have been changing them with the beginning of domestication of animals. So, that is why I am saying that we are beginning with agriculture, simply because to make you understand that industrial revolution or post-industrial changes should not be seen only as responsible cause for changes in environment. We have been changing it since long back, at least 14,000 years back. Now, agriculture, what agriculture provided were two very important things. And I would like to stress these two points to make you understand the larger argument of this course itself. What they made us available? Surplus food and surplus time. At the age of hunting gathering, we were, as a humans, we were continuously hunting and gathering. Throughout the year, we were busy. We were migrating with the availability of resources. In this region, if the there is a depletion of animals, we migrate to a region which is much more better bestowed with the animals. So, we have been migrating that region. But with agriculture, now we were cultivating for 3 to 4 months. And for the rest of the 9 months, we have generated enough surplus within these 3 to 4 months. So, for the first times, humans now have a spare time. This spare time leads to various sociological changes on one hand, various economic changes on the other hand, various political changes on the other hand. For example, now there is a specialization of craft. Why? Because now you have sufficient time, those 9 months. Within those 9 months, you are exploring nature, you are exploring environment, the nearby area. And then you are coming across with metals. Earlier you were using basically lithic, the stone tools. Now you are venturing into discovery of metals, the copper, bronze is discovered. Indus Valley civilization, Mish civilization, Mish means Egyptian civilization, Mesopotamian civilization, Shang civilization, China, all the four civilizations are, ancient civilizations are pre-Iron Age civilizations, or they are termed as Bronze Age civilizations. Now, humans have discovered bronze, a metal which can be reused. Unlike a stone, which once used is gone, you can only reshape it. But with the metal, you can remelt it and reshape it. So, now you are recycling your resource. This change is very, very important, because with this intervention in the environment, you started a specialization of craft. Those spare 9 months were enough time for humans to explore region across them. Another integrated change which came with the introduction of agriculture is urbanization. Urban centers very loosely can be termed as parasites. Parasite, they depend on resources of nature, resources of rural landscape. They are not primary producer. In Delhi, we don't cultivate, we don't produce for ourselves. What we are dependent on, whatever is being produced in our rural landscape, we are using that. So, we are parasite on the resources being produced by agriculture sector. Since agriculture is producing surplus, as I mentioned earlier, that surplus is sustaining a large population in urban center. By creation of an urban center, you have once again modified natural landscape. We can, if we wish to, term this as a degradation. And the better sites were contested, that is environmental conflict. A urban center which is very closer to a very good source of water will be contested among various claimants. They are not trying to control urban center. What they are trying to control, the strategic location of that urban center, because that strategic location is one and unique, because that is being provided by cattle by a particular river at a particular juncture you have constructed this. Look at ancient cities of India, Banaras, Haridwar, Kanpur, Allahabad, moved towards Calcutta. Most of these were situated on along the river course. Later on, when civilization moved, you start centers emerging on the major trade routes. But even those centers who were located in a desert region were also located very close to a regular water source, otherwise they would not sustain. So, the strategic location was very important, and that strategic location is specific to that particular environment which is being contested. Any army invading any landscape was not interested in landscape, was interested in agrarian production, was interested in the place where that agrarian production is being invested. You must have heard Somnath was invaded time and again. There was a reason for invading Somnath. They were basically invading the resources of the area, but it was accumulated at Somnath. So, the site of Somnath in term is a very important environmental site to be understood as a appropriate center where resources of larger hinterland is being accumulated and used for secondary tertiary production system. When I say secondary tertiary production, please understand what I am trying to say. Agrarian production is primary production. It supplies us the food, but the cloth which we are wearing is the secondary production, weaving, etc. There are multiple uses. On the other hand, the metallurgy which I mentioned earlier, metallurgy is also secondary production. You have extracted, but you are not investing primarily in natural landscape. So, do you want to break at the moment? Because then I can begin with the next slot. What I would like to say, with the metallurgy, humans were interested in managing the natural resources with the availability of food at their disposal, which Neolithic revolution has provided. Now, let us take a break of 1 minute, and then we will come back and discuss another dimension of this process. Thank you. Thank you. Welcome viewers. In this session of this lecture, I will be discussing the implications of demographic changes which were introduced due to introduction of Neolithic Revolution on agriculture and further developments. This is basically an introduction to the larger course which we are going to discuss with you all. When I say the demographic change, what I mean is that the agrarian revolution or the Neolithic Revolution introduced made available a large amount of surplus in terms of agrarian surplus. That surplus helped an increase in population. With the growth in population, more and more agricultural land is being used, being cultivated, which means more and more production is made available so that you can increase your own population once again. So this cycle continues, and much later Malthus theorized it, that I will be coming later on. But at the moment, let me chart out with you the implications of this demographic change, how this led to global environmental conflicts, in what way it is very important for us to understand. When we started discussing Neolithic Revolution, we were also discussing that with the introduction, later on urbanization emerged. Urbanization, the major urban centers which emerged were part of Bronze Age civilization, be it industrial civilization, Harappa, Mohenjo-daro, Lothal, etcetera, etcetera, Kalibangan, the numerous one. Similarly, along the Nile River, we have the Pharaohs and all those cities. In Mesopotamia, we have cities. So these cities, when these cities emerged at a very strategic location. What is more important for me is that this strategic location also helped in growth of population. Now the demographic profile needs to be understood, not in terms of only increase in population, but also in terms of the division of labor in one hand, the emergence of class, in Indian case later on caste. So caste, class notions had emerged, and all these came with privileges or absence of privileges. These privileges means you have better access to more natural resources, which means those who don't enjoy those privileges were deprived of access towards those natural resources. It's expected that you will see conflict over natural resources. Can we term this as environmental conflicts? To a great extent, we can and we must, because that gives a new perspective to history. That gives a new perspective to understanding human past. Why it is important? It is important to make you understand that past societies were not living in harmony as we try to portray today. There were contestation, there were conflicts, and these conflicts were most of the time for better environmental facilities available in their region or in their location. Similarly, equally important for us to understand in this context is that with the stratification of civilization, with the stratification of society, few had greater access to natural resources, few had greater control over natural resources. So this control was also contested. We must understand, earlier societies were highly stratified. If I borrow from Indian case, which you will be much more familiar with, then the lower caste, especially the Shudras, had no right. They were deprived of any right. They cannot own the land, which means they cannot own any kind of natural resource. If that is the case, then the conflict was inherent in the nature of social structure. We have been ignoring that because we have been focusing on post-industrial societies. But as an environmental historian, my concern is to make it much more problematic, so that we start looking at these societies in a different manner. We must place environment at the center of our investigation, rather than placing a king at the center of investigation, or production process at the center of investigation, or conflict over resources at the center of investigation. Rather, if we place environment, the landscape, then we might get a different perspective. I am not suggesting a better perspective, but I am definitely suggesting a different perspective which will complement to the earlier understanding of the same civilization. That is what I am trying to argue when I am discussing demographic changes with you. These demographic changes also led to increase in population, as I have been discussing. With the increase in population, the demand for natural resources started increasing. If demand for natural resources is increasing, what is but natural is to expect expansion of agriculture, expansion of empires, conflict over empires. Sikandar the Great, the whole Roman Empire, this is expansionist empires, because they were looking for more and more resources to acquire so that their mother country can be better placed. The whole notion of slave mode of production is basically part of this control over natural resources. No. Let me once again make it very clear what I am trying to suggest. This whole process of expansion by Roman Empire is to control natural resources of other region, which led to emergence of slave mode of production. Let me spell it out, I mean to say. Slave mode of production, which means a large population was converted into slave. Who is a slave? Slave is a human like me. He doesn't enjoy any right, No property, no family, etc., etc. If a large section was enjoying no privileges, why were they important for Roman Empire? They were important for Roman Empire simply because they were the primary source of energy for them. They were the mover of their agriculture. They were the mover of their civilization. Those who had no right were basically the mainstay of Roman civilization. Slave mode of production, the moment Roman expansion ceases, it becomes difficult for Roman Empire to sustain itself, because the natural resources in the name of slaves were no longer available to the Roman services of Roman Empire. So, slave mode of production is basically appropriation of energy resources in terms of humans from different land, from foreign land, for the services of my parent land or my mother country. So, the conflict of natural resources should also be seen in terms of conflict over human resources. Let me further elaborate on that, because this is very important as a dimension to understand. Humans were important source of energy. Let's go back to era when fossil energy was not used. The fossil fuels were not available to us. What were the sources of energy with our disposal? The next slide discusses that. The fossil fuels are basically fuel which were unearthed from the earth. Prior to that, you were using wind energy, you were using solar energy, and you were using animal power. Please understand, and water energy. Water, solar, wind, all the three are specific to their location. They cannot be shifted. Whereas humans is a mobile source of energy. Animal is a mobile source of energy. They can be transported, used in different locations where they are not naturally available. You cannot divert a river, you cannot divert wind, you cannot divert solar energy to a place where they are not naturally available. But the human resources, the animal resources can be diverted, which means there is a continuous conflict over human resources as well as animal resources. I teach medieval history of Rajasthan, and in the beginning of most of these principalities, Mewar, Marwar, Jaipur, the history is full of evidences where the ruler, the early rulers, were looting. They were capturing the karvas of animals and karvas of horses, karvas of camels for their own army, for their own empire, or for their own kingdom. So, the conflict over natural resources could also be seen in terms of conflict over human power, as slave mode of production have seen, and as a control over other sources of natural resources like animal power, the camel, horses, elephant. Another example, might make you much more easy for you to understand. Mughals, when we came from the west of India and they started capturing India, they were basically cavalry driven, though they were carrying gunpowder, but their mainstay of army was cavalry, horsepower. But as they moved eastward, as they moved towards Bihar and Bengal, they were forced to shift from cavalry to elephantry, because horses were not feasible to be used in floodplains of Bihar and Bengal. You cannot capture Assam if you are riding on horse. They very soon realized, and they shifted their army from cavalry to elephantry whenever they moved eastward, which means now they are requiring elephant. Elephants were available in plenty of numbers in with the Gond kings of Chhattisgarh, which is now central India. So the Mughals were contesting over elephants available in those areas. This is also a kind of environmental conflict which we would like to discuss when we proceed with this course. So the demographic change on the one hand leads to contest over human resources. On the other hand, it also leads to control over other kind of resources which are mobile. I have been stressing the point that agriculture was mainstay of most of these civilizations. If agriculture was mainstay, which means land is prime mover. Agriculture means land. So they were controlling land. With that land, they can move around. But land is also immobile. It cannot be shifted from this place to that place. Another equally important, James C. Scott mentioned this very, very clearly and very emphatically, that mere availability of land is of no use to any empire. You have plenty of land at your disposal. What will you do with this? Unless you have energy resources to cultivate that and make it profitable. And that energy resource is either animals or human power. Unless human power is used to cultivate that land, it is of no use to us. Humans cannot cultivate unless they deploy animal power. So the conflict is of multiple nature. At the moment, unfortunately, the modern day students basically focus on energy resources, which they think in terms of fossil fuel, etc. only. What I am trying to suggest that when we move to pre-industrial age, then we see a very different picture of environmental conflicts. That we will be discussing when we meet next. But at the moment, let me also move when we see beginning of fossil fuel, because this is an introductory lecture. Fossil fuel, what they did? Massive change in terms of, now with the availability of fossil fuel, your machine can run 24 hours 7 days a week continuously, unlike animals or humans who require relief, who would like to relax, who need time to regenerate. These machines can run 24 hours 7 days a week. Humans cannot work beyond 20 hours. You need to give them rest. Animal cannot work beyond a particular time of limit. So you need to give them rest. But with the machine which is run by fossil fuel, it can run continuously. If it has to run continuously, then you require continuous supply of fuel, another natural resource, highly contested resource. It's not only the fuel is required, but whatever machine is trying to produce, you require raw material. Raw material needs to be supplied continuously simply because the machine is running 24 hours, 7 days a week. So there is conflict over natural resources. You must have heard British colonialism in India, British controlling India. They were controlling primarily for this purpose. They required our raw material, especially cotton for their textile industry. Later on, other kind of colonialism emerges, but primarily for agriculture, primarily for textile. So the conflict is over fossil fuel, conflict is over for raw material. No, it doesn't stop here. These machines, with the help of this raw material, is producing good. Unless you have market at your disposal, where will you sell those goods? If you are not able to sell those goods, the market prices will crash and your margin of profit will vanish. So you not only require continuous supply of fossil fuel, you not only require continuous supply of raw material, you also require continuous supply of consumption or the market. So you need to destroy markets which are running on its natural basis or indigenous basis. You need to replace those markets. The demands need to be changed so that the produce which you are generating through your machine, which is run on fossil fuel, which is now producing mass production, needs to be consumed. Unless it is consumed, the whole system will collapse. So the contest is over fossil fuel, the contest is over natural resources, raw material, and the contest is over the human population which is going to consume that. All this is environmental conflict at multiple levels, at various levels you are witnessing conflict over natural resources. Earlier humans were contested or controlled for energy resources. Now humans need to be controlled for their consumption purposes. Unless we consume more and more, the whole industry will collapse. That is why the whole advertisement, the consumer world, replace this, get this, in exchange you will get that. What they are doing, they are feeding your demands. Simply because unless your demand is fed, their production will not sustain. Which means it's a vicious cycle which is now damaging more and more natural resources and leading to emergence of more and more intense environmental conflicts, the global environmental conflicts. Another dimension which I would like to discuss here is with the expansion of agriculture, with the expansion of urbanization, what we witness is limited space available for wildlife. And India, it is particularly important. You go to Assam, you go to Nilgiris, soon you realize that elephants venture out of their wild and they come to urban centers. They destroy agriculture fields. If you have sugarcane field in your neighborhood, you can expect elephants anytime. It's not the problem of elephant. It's problem that you have reduced forest land so much that they are forced to venture into agricultural landscape. This is another kind of environmental conflict which we need to understand. The genesis of this environmental conflict is once again lies in the agriculture revolution. Expansion of agriculture, demographic change, change in the consumption pattern, fossil fuel, all this is putting more and more pressure on natural resources, more and more pressure on environment. Environment which is to be enjoyed by wild in equal terms as we are doing. They are equal claimant. We don't enjoy any special claim over nature. Any animal, be a very small or be big like elephant, all of them enjoy equal right over nature. So any attempt to reduce their land is another manifestation of global environmental conflicts. It's so much so that India has witnessed elimination of extinction of various animals. The most prominent which I can cite at the moment is extinction of cheetah. Cheetahs were used by Mughals extensively for hunting purposes. Unfortunately, cheetah could never breed in captivity, It bred only in, it produced progenies only in wild. So Mughals could not control them, could not force them to reproduce in captivity. And with the coming of gunpowder, with the coming of guns, with the Britishers, Mughals were also using guns, but with the Britishers is intensified, and now we don't have a single cheetah in Indian subcontinent. There is a plan to import it from another country so that cheetah is reintroduced in India. That is manifestation of environmental conflict. Unfortunately, these animals don't have a voice. So we as an environmentalist, we as a historians, we as a biologist need to give them voice. Most of the time, we have been focusing on human need and implications of that. But we must understand in what ways, in what manner, at what point of time we have been putting pressure on wild. Another important concept which I must introduce before we conclude, because now we are left with 10 minutes only, is global hotspots, biological hotspots. India, being in tropical country, is fortunately bestowed with several biological hotspots, where the biodiversity is immense and we need to protect that biodiversity. How are we going to do that? We need to control any expansion of agriculture or urban center in that area. We need to resist our temptation to create a highway across that. We need to resist our temptation to create a railway link across that hotspot. It will put additional cost, but we must understand it will reduce environmental conflict, which will ultimately benefit in a longer run only for the humans. So these are the issues which needs to be understood, and for that we are trying to develop this course, Global Environmental Conflict. Another equally important for me at the moment before concluding is to share with you a bibliography for these issues which I am trying to outline. This bibliography is basically introductory bibliography, where you get an oversight of issues. I would like to especially stress the last book, Daniel Botkin's Discordant Harmonies, A New Ecology for the 21st Century. It's a must read for anybody who is interested in issues of environment, simply because it suggests that there is discord in harmonies with the greater power available with the humans to control nature, to control wild. We are disturbing that harmonies. He is no way suggesting that these harmonies were natural. He is simply suggesting all these harmonies are product of time. They have been changing. There is no one harmony. It's a continuous process of harmonies. But now these harmonies are being damaged, being changed. Another important book which I would like to mention you is the first one, Mahesh Rangarajan and K. Shivaramakrishnan edited, India's Environmental History. It's a 2-volume book, and it's basically a collection of essays. And you will benefit immensely from this essay, these essays, simply because they cover from ancient times to modern times. The limitation of this book for this course is simply that it focuses on India, only on India. The second reading which I have mentioned is a 1-page reading, but it's a must read for anybody who would like to understand that the nature is not static. The title is very important. Stationarity is dead. We must understand that nature is not static. It is changing, it is fluid, it is dynamic. Since it is changing, so we must be prepared for those changes and negotiate those changes, understand those changes, and then proceed with amendment in our living pattern so that we negotiate with that. And last but not the least, Vasant Sabharwal's book, Vasant Sabharwal and Mahesh Rangarajan's book, Battles Over Nature, Science and the Politics of Conservation. Please remember, the science plays its own politics, and we need to be very careful with that dimension. Whatever science produces or science prescribes may not be valid all the time, because science is trying to keep certain dimension in focus. So, Battles Over Nature is a conflict between what science tries to prescribe and what social science tries to achieve. So we need to maintain a balance between absolute scientific perspective and absolute human-centric approach. We need to make a balance between these two to reduce the nature and amount of conflicts over ecological issues. Thank you very much.
Sir, I have a quick question for you. So that the debate we have been outlining here is that you're saying that the wars that took place in the past were not so much about the political reasons, but was more about the ecological reasons. That it was more about the more about controlling the resources, and rather less than, if I can put it like this, that it's less about, say, for war of succession.
Right.
Who is succeeding the king is not important, but who is controlling the resources is important.
Absolutely.
And in with that, if I can just chip in one more thing, that in that context, in that sense, that will colonialism and imperialism, as we have known, would you be saying that it was about controlling the resources of the colony for the prosperity for motherland, and not exactly for, again, for the political reasons? If we can,
it's difficult to segregate in terms of political reasons and economic reason, but we can for sure say economic reasons dominated. For economic control, they were deploying political resources. Colonialism is a political manifestation of control over economy of India, economy of any other part. In the same way, I would like to state that war is a basically consumption. War is a basically expenditure. Any war is means expenditure. So if you are spending, then you need to accumulate more and more. So you are spending, you are investing to capture another land so that you can use the resources of that land for your own purposes. So in a way, it is conflict over natural resources. Otherwise, no war will be fought. You are fighting to control war of succession, as you mentioned. I would like to control the land rather than my brother or my cousin controlling over it. What I am trying to control? I am trying to control the resources which this region provides. Nobody will be interested, if you read the history, nobody is interested in controlling a desert land. Nobody is interested in ancient time to control the mountains because it is not producing anything. When today we are protecting Kargil, it is primarily for strategic reasons. But earlier, the wars were fought primarily for control over resources which were limited. Unless fossil fuel were introduced and mass production began, prior to that, it was control over natural resources and most importantly, control over human resources which were important. That is why I am saying that war should be seen as a contest over resources.
Okay, sir. On that note, I would like to thank sir for this very enriching discussion, and I would like to thank you, dear friends, for watching our show, and I hope that you have attained a different perspective over history that we have tried to elaborate before you here. On that note, I would like to thank you, dear friends.
Thanks.
For watching our show. Stay tuned and keep watching. Thank you.
Thank you very much.